Misses.
Misses. Good, follow me. In favor, step up into that box, remain standing. Just make your way up, remain standing, raise your right hand, face that gentleman right there.
You solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give this afternoon, the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but truth, so help you God.
Yes, I do.
Thank you, may be seated. Please state your complete name, spelling both your first and last name for record.
DASHA GIRALDO.
And how do you pronounce it, ma'am?
Dasha.
And last name?
Giraldo.
Thank you very much.
Ms. Giraldo, where do you live, or where did you live in August of 2014?
3404 Pueblo Way, Las Vegas.
Las Vegas. And who did you live with at that residence?
My husband and my daughter.
And what's your husband's name?
Alberto.
How old's your daughter?
Right now?
Or was she in 2014?
25.
Okay. Can you describe that neighborhood generally for us?
Very quiet, very safe, on a golf course, watching people playing golf, picking up golf balls.
I want to draw your attention to August 8th of 2014, around 4 o'clock in the morning. Do you recall that morning?
Yes.
Okay. What were you doing at about 4 o'clock in the morning?
Sleeping.
And did anything awake you from your sleep at that time?
We hear a loud noise on the kitchen door. Banging.
Banging? What did you do after you heard the banging?
We both ran downstairs, the dog were barking, and I think my husband looked through the window and he saw a person bending down, hiding in front of the kitchen door.
How many dogs were at your residence at that time?
Three small dogs inside.
After the banging, did the dogs begin to bark?
Yes.
When you went downstairs, where did you go?
I also looked through the window and I saw a person covered with a blanket, and I hear a banging and I see some blood marks on her face.
Okay. When you got downstairs, describe for me the kitchen door.
Well, the kitchen door is half glass, but it's not see-through. You have to really look through to see who, if you see somebody, to see in, outside.
So it's not necessarily like a clear window that you can just look through?
No, but we have a room next to it as a clear window. That's when I went and looked and I saw somebody bending on the floor and hiding.
So you went into a room next to, near the kitchen door?
Yes, and I have the whole view from the to the front yard.
And at that time, what did you see when you looked through the window?
Well, it looked scary. There was somebody, a small body with a blanket, and I kind of looked from the window. She saw me, and I see marks on her face. Her hair were all like this, and I couldn't see her face. It was very, very Asian-looking lady.
All right. The window that you looked through in the room window, mm-hmm. is that like a normal classic window?
Yes.
So you were able to see through that?
Yes. But it still was 4 o'clock in the morning.
Okay. Were there any lights on outside near the kitchen door?
We have an emergency light that goes on, but I don't...
You don't recall?
Yeah.
Okay.
All
right. After looking through the window, what did you do?
I call immediately 911, and I think the first time they hang up the phone on me. So I call again, and I told them that I see somebody from my door, and I'm scared to open.
Okay.
And they say, don't open the door. Who is that? How does it look like? So I describe what I see from the clear window.
Mm-hmm. The person that you saw through the window, was that someone that you recognized at that time?
Not at that time. No, I don't know who it was. That's why I was scared to open the door.
When, after you called police, did you make another phone call to police later on that?
Yes, we made a couple of phone calls.
Your Honor, I would move for the admission of State's proposed exhibits 156 and 157.
Any objection?
There is not.
They're admitted.
Ms. Giraldo, as we listen to this, I may have more questions for you afterwards, okay?
Okay.
Friday, August 8, 2014, 04:02:27.
911 emergency, VoIP 14553.
Can you point where you're calling? Yes, I need a police or medical. There's a light in front of my door, it's not by the phone.
Oh,
can
you check your door right now?
Yes, I'm glad.
Is he outside?
Yes, he's outside.
Okay. And
did you know she's going to try to open my door?
Okay.
I'm afraid to open the door.
What is your name?
My name is Giraldo, G-I-R-A-L-D-O.
And your birthday?
Sasha, D-A-N-D-O. How do you send the police?
Okay, hold on, I have to talk to you. Okay, do
you see
the outside
there? I'm in the room. It's a pajama from the
street. Right, I'm in the decoration.
Excuse me?
Is he white, black, and green? About how old is he?
I don't know, 35.
Small B, you said small B. What color shirt? What color pants? What's your word?
I cannot hear you, just about to kiss me.
What color shirt? What color pants?
I don't know, it's nice, honey, so it's like a robot.
Is he therapy drinking? Do you need any drugs?
No, no, she's all crying in front of my door. She was saying the police have crashed that somebody cut them with a knife.
It looks like someone cut her with a knife.
Yeah.
So did you like see blood all down her face?
Yeah.
And you didn't let her inside,
okay? No, I wasn't ready.
Okay. I
think
I got a call set up. We
want to
get somebody out there
in the
kitchen, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
And this is the house or the
apartment?
House. And
verify your phone number, please. 702-663-0537.
Okay, got it. Thank you, then.
And that, was that the first phone call where you spoke to 911?
I spoke, yeah.
And you were able to describe her at that time?
Well, I look better. I don't know who it was. And so I look better from the clear window. I see with the long hair, I assume it was a woman.
Okay. Later on, you made a second phone call, correct?
Yes.
Your Honor, the state, it's previously been admitted. The state moved for the admission of, published 157.
Go ahead.
I call at the minute to the phone to the lady on top of body in front of my door, screaming and crying.
I'm sorry, you said the lady in front of your door screaming and crying?
Yes, it's on top. I said it's on top and I'm afraid to open the door. Excuse me?
Is it her face
in the cut? Yes, but I need a police or somebody.
okay, yeah, we have that.
She's hiding. What? Excuse me?
Yeah, you just called. Do you have it?
Yeah, but nobody's here.
Well, man, you called like 4 minutes ago.
Well, the police is around the corner.
They're not around the corner from your house.
The entire people are around the corner.
No.
I don't know what to do.
So, let's take a deep breath and relax, okay? We're trying to figure it out. Do you know this person?
I think I know her. I don't know if she was Asian, but she's probably beating up. I gotta go find some training.
I understand. Do you see anybody else outside or
no? No, I'm scared. Alright,
let's take a deep breath and we're gonna get help on the way, okay?
Let's get help on the way. Hurry up!
Why did you make that second phone call?
Because nobody came. It was a long time until somebody showed up. Nobody called, asked if something is going on there. So we make another phone call to make sure that somebody's coming to see what's going on.
You obviously testified that you woke up and went to the kitchen window or the side window. Did your husband also wake up?
Yes, we both wake up.
And do you know whether or not he made any phone calls to 911?
He made a very upset phone call also after I called and nobody showed up, then he called again with his cell phone, I think.
So after that second call, there was another phone call made?
Yes.
Did you ever attempt to communicate with the lady that was outside your room?
No, because at that time, I don't know who she was. Okay. Now I feel bad that I didn't open the door for her.
I want to show you.
Hold on, I'm going to object and move to strike that last portion. It's not responsive.
Sustained, so the last statement will be disregarded by the jury.
Exhibit 178, after the statement of first admission, I believe there's no objection.
There is no objection.
178?
Correct, Your Honor.
Submitted.
Thank you. Ms. Giraldo, do you recognize what we're looking at here?
Oh, let me see. Yeah, that's my neighborhood.
Okay. And this street here is Eastern.
Yes.
Can you locate your home for us on this screen? And if you'll touch the screen where your home is, it should appear. All right. So you're this house here with the kind of red roof?
Yes.
Did the individual that is outside your home, did she stay there until police arrived?
No.
Did you see where she went?
Yeah, she keep on walking in the cul-de-sac on the side street, and she went across the street to the house and knocked at the door.
Okay. And so we're clear on this this map. You kind of made it with your right hand motion. Was she coming from this way over to this way?
Yes, yes.
I'll pass the witness, Your Honor.
All right, press.
Good afternoon.
Hello.
Prior to this August 8th incident, have you ever met the Mr. Copenhaver and Ms. McIntyre?
Yes.
Yeah. And Ms. McIntyre had stated in the preliminary hearing that she I never met you before. Would that be a correct statement or is that false?
The girl who was from my door, she never met me before.
If she said that, would that be a true statement?
I met her before.
You have met her before. And?
Very shortly, very briefly.
And how did you meet her?
I met her. Her dog got loose and came in my front yard, so I brought him back to the house.
And when her dog got loose and in your front yard, isn't it true that the dog bit you?
Objection, that's still relevant. Come on up.
You can make a proffer on that, Your Honor.
Go ahead, ask the question.
Isn't it true that Ms. McInday's dog had ditch in the hand?
Yeah.
And?
In my finger.
Okay, and after the dog bit you, did you further have communications with Ms. McInday?
One day she found a dog, and she knocked with her mother on my door, thinking that's my dog, because my dog was little, so she was thinking it's my dog. So they both came to my house in the evening and showed me the dog.
And isn't it true that Ms. McInday paid for the dog's vet bills after that?
Yes.
And when did you meet Mr. Copenhaver?
He came to the house with his girlfriend, and just to say thank you that I brought the dog back.
And did they bring you anything?
They bring me chocolate from Europe, European deli store.
Now, on August 8, 2014, you state that Ms. McInday was banging on the door, correct?
Yes.
Is that the front door or the back door?
Kitchen door.
The kitchen door, and where's the kitchen located?
Kitchen door is located by the, our driveway. Like when you go from the street into the driveway, my kitchen door is right there. And the main entrance is on the other side of the house.
And so to gain closest access to that kitchen door, would that be from the front yard or the back yard?
Say it again.
To gain access to that kitchen door, would that be from the front yard or the back?
From the front yard. From the
front yard? Yeah. And so when you went down to the door, did you go by yourself or did your husband go down to the door with you?
Our bedroom is at the second floor, so we both ran downstairs to see what's going on. I don't know who looked.
But both of you went down with you?
Both of us, yeah.
And that's when you saw an individual wrapped in a blanket?
Yes.
Can you describe what that blanket looked like?
Oh, I don't know. Just something. She had something over her head.
And
I don't know.
Was the blanket covering the rest of her body as well?
How was it?
Was the blanket covering the rest of her body as well?
Yeah, she was covered, I think, like this. That's why when I look from the other window, I could see she's got a bloody face.
So it was a large blanket covering her body?
Yeah.
And did you notice anything strange about the blanket?
No, I was not concerned about the blanket.
Now, you stated that when you saw her, she had hair, and you described it like this.
Yeah.
Can you describe what you meant by that?
Well, her hair was sticking up like this. It was nighttime. I see bloody face. I see somebody, like this, and her hair was messed up.
And at that time, did you see a lot of hair?
A lot of hair, yeah.
Yeah. Now, when Ms. McInday left your house, you said that she was walking along the cul-de-sac, correct?
Yes, sir.
And would that be out on the main street?
No, on the sidewalk.
On the sidewalk?
It is a sidewalk that goes around, and she was walking on the sidewalk.
And is that the sidewalk that adjoins or abuts the main street? When I say the main street, I'm talking about the street that you live on.
Yeah, she was walking on the sidewalk from my house, in the cul-de-sac, but on the sidewalk where people are walking, no
okay,
cars.
And so this sidewalk, is this in plain view, or is this like a hidden sidewalk?
No, it's in plain view.
In view? And was she running at the time, or walking?
Walking.
Walking? Were you with your husband when your husband called 911?
When she was already walking, I went to the second floor to have a better view where she's going. So when I look for her, so I can tell them where she was. I think my husband was downstairs. I don't know where he was at that time.
And did you stay alert to this situation
Yes.
until the police arrived?
Yes.
You did? And when your husband called, he stated to the 911 operator that there's a lady outside down on the curb.
Objection.
Did you witness that as well?
Right. So,
I'll re-ask
don't,
the question.
Don't repeat what was said by someone else.
Did you ever see Ms. McInday sitting out on the curb?
Sitting?
Yes.
I don't remember.
Do you remember her laying by the curb?
No.
Laying,
no.
By the curb.
I just saw her. I went up the stairs, and what she was doing between that time, I don't know. But I saw her walking to the neighbor's house, hoping maybe somebody will open the door for her.
So you don't have a recollection of her sitting out in the coach?
No.
And where was she at the time that the police had arrived?
She was behind the bushes across the street from my neighbors.
Nothing further at this time.
Okay, read your
No, thank you, Your Honor.
Okay. Thanks, ma'am.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
The time. All right, next.
State calls Alberto Giraldo.
Good, follow me. Can you favor step up into that box? Do you mind standing for a second? Raise your right hand, face that gentleman right there for me.
You solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give this action will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, self of God.
I do.
Thank you. You may be seated. Please state your complete name, spelling both your first and last name for the record.
Alberto Giraldo.
Spell it first, please, sir.
Excuse me?
Spell your first and last name.
First name, A-L-B-R-T-O. Last name, G-I-R-A-L-D-O.
Thank you.
MC. Thank you. Mr. Giraldo, I'm showing you what's been marked as Exhibit 178. You recognize this?
Yes, I do.
Were you living in this neighborhood on August 8th of 2014?
Yes.
Can you point on the screen next to you there which house you were living in at that time?
It's the last house on the right hand of the picture. With a red roof.
Okay. Will you touch it for us? It'll show up on the screen if you touch
it. Sure.
So this house right here?
Correct.
Who was living in that home at that time?
My wife and I.
Your wife?
My wife.
Oh, my
wife. Yeah.
Do you recall if your daughter was living there at that time?
Probably yes, because she travels a lot. I think she was home. I don't remember. Besides.
All right. What were you doing at around 4 o'clock in the morning on August 8th, 2014?
Sleeping.
All right. And were you sleeping in any particular bedroom?
Our master bedroom upstairs.
Upstairs?
Yes, it's two floors.
Did anything awake you from your sleep?
Yes, my dogs were barking very badly. Okay. And I hear some kind of knock on one of the doors.
Can you describe the knock for us?
It's like a very fast, no regular knock.
How many dogs did you have at that time?
Three small dogs.
When they bark, are they kind of loud and boisterous?
Oh yeah, they really go wild.
All right. What do you do after you heard that knock on the door?
I went downstairs to the kitchen, which is, has a door going to the garage, has a big window, and I was yelling, I thought it was my brother-in-law, who, and I, Tony, and nobody answered.
This door, can you describe it for us?
It's a regular door, but very wide window with a sandblaster design, so you can see through.
Okay.
You can see through well.
Okay. So you can see through it, but is it difficult to see through?
It's really difficult because as I say, it's sandblaster for the design.
And it was your testimony that you believed, I believe you said it was your brother?
My brother-in-law. I thought it would be my brother-in-law trying to get in for whatever reason, so.
Okay. And you yelled out, Tony, did
I yelled, Tony, no answer.
And then what did you do?
And then somebody appeared in front of my, and the glass window and scared the hell out of me. Excuse me, the word scares me because I couldn't recognize that person was like a monster covered with a blanket, and then I run upstairs.
Okay. You thought it was a monster covered with a blanket?
Somebody very a mask or something, I don't know, was very scary. Okay. I may say.
At the time that you were looking through this window and this individual popped up into your view, do you know where your wife was at that time?
I believe it was upstairs at that time, making a phone call.
Okay.
To 911.
And you testified after you saw this person kind of jump up, you ran upstairs also.
Correct.
What did you do when you were upstairs?
I went to get my gun.
Why'd you do that?
Because a week or two weeks before, I know precisely the day, was a case in Tropicana and the area, more or less, that someone was killed because some lady knocked on his door, and he was nice enough to let him in, and then a guy behind came in and killed this man. So that came to my mind right away, so that's why I didn't open the door, because that was thinking in my head.
Okay. After you went upstairs, were you successful in obtaining your gun?
Oh, yes, indeed.
Okay. Did you ever go back downstairs in attempts to communicate with this individual?
No, really. I just was wondering how it was going to be next. If it was going to break the door or what.
Okay. Okay. You said you believe that your wife was upstairs making a phone call. Do you know who she was calling?
911, for sure.
Did you make any phone calls to 911?
Indeed, because I thought the police were taking a little longer than I expected for a case that we thought it was very, something bad happened. I don't know what that. We didn't want the police to arrive as soon as possible.
This individual that popped up into your view, did this individual say anything to you? Was she yelling?
No, that I remember, no.
So you contacted 911 because you thought the response was a little delayed?
Correct.
Okay. Your Honor, I would move for the admission of State's Proposed Exhibit 158.
There's no objection.
Submitted, thank you.
Now I move to publish it also at this time.
Sure, go ahead.
I may have some questions for you after this, please.
911 emergency 19-844.
Thank you. I'm going to go to the medical center here from my dock, my house. We don't know what's going on. All busy, all kind of people are not here. I'm waiting. Is it from my house? Yes, please go to my parents, you sense. Okay. I don't want to open the door. It happened before the people across the street. Have you come? And I saw somebody come in. I don't know if you saw somebody.
What is the address, sir?
3404 Pueblo Way.
And what's your name?
Huh? Alberto Gerardo. Alberto Gerardo. She walked in the street and she went across the street from the house. This is getting very bad. I don't know how to
help. What's going on with her?
I don't know, baby. She's outside bleeding. I don't know. She started bleeding out. She's in bad shape.
Okay, let me update the call. Hold on. How do you spell your last name, Alberto?
G-I-R-A-L-D-O. I will open the door, but what happened to the
other day? Don't open the door.
Yeah, but I can hear if somebody, if she tries to get in, I have to shoot somebody. Because I don't want to happen here to my family or something.
Okay, do you have a weapon now?
Yes. Okay. I see her across the street. You want to see her walking across the street to open the other door there. I see her.
Do you know what happened to her?
No idea, lady. She's outside. I don't want to open the door yet. The police have to find out. I don't. They should be already in police here a long time ago.
Do you recognize her from the neighborhood?
I think she's this a few blocks away, looks like, because she has some tattoos. And I think there's a lady who lives about a block away from my house. Looks like her. But she's been so, she did so bad that I don't know, recognize.
Okay. But
look like one.
What is she wearing? Do you know what color shirt and pants?
She's wearing a robe, a cover, like a bed cover, black and white.
And she's across the street now?
Across the street.
Is she knocking at your neighbor's house?
I guess so. I can't see her across the street. Now you call her very wrong. Now she's there.
Shoot, what is she doing?
She's back there living again there, the house there.
When she had it?
No, she's still there, still there.
She's still down the street?
Yeah.
And she's waiting for the state?
For the state, that she's called the race. She left somebody there or whatever, I don't know. Maybe it's just some, I don't know. The police have to investigate, I tell you what it is. It's a problem around here, it should be here.
Down the way, sir, they're driving there. So, just stay inside, don't open your door, and officers will be out there to see what's going on.
Okay.
Don't go outside with your gun.
Excuse me?
Do not go outside with your gun, officer.
No, I would not, no.
Okay.
No, I would not do that.
You'll put your gun away?
Yeah, well, the moment the police come in here, I will put away, I mean, I have it here, wait.
Okay, I understand, officers are on the way, so it shouldn't be much.
But if we call the radio, by the door, it should be here already.
Yeah, it was 10 minutes ago, so the officers are driving there now.
So it's a long time, but people die in that time.
Okay, I understand, but it's been busy, so they're on the way now.
There'll be more hurry, because already this happened twice already, and this town people are not gonna do it, and they're gonna get killed.
Alright, thank you.
Alright, Mr. Gerald, I have a couple more questions for you, okay? Do you recall what she had on her body at that time?
It was like a blanket cover, you know, over her body.
And you recall the colors of that blanket or cover?
Yes, it was kind of yellow, black, something like blanket. It was a pattern anyway.
If you made statements to the 911 operator, do you imagine those would be accurate at that time?
That is correct.
There was also some mention that you said she was bleeding pretty badly.
What I mean is because of the face, but as I said, I thought it was blood because it's scary, I'll be honest with you. It was very scary because when she pumped up, I mean, so I imagine it was bleeding that somebody had beaten or whatever.
Yeah. And you described her as looking like a monster.
That's correct. Very scary.
There's a point in that 911 call where you say she's going across the street. Did you actually see her walking across the street?
Indeed, yes, from my window I can see very clearly.
Was this through the kitchen window or was this
no,
through
upstairs.
The... upstairs?
Yeah.
Okay. And if you look at the map with me again, this is exhibit 178. Do you recall where she was headed?
To walk to this house, exactly, in front of the house. The one like a green roof looks.
Okay. You said with the green roof?
Yeah, I mean, is it maybe the pool? I don't know.
All right, let me ask you, was it this one or this one?
That one, the last one, yeah.
Of course, I'll pass it. Mm-hmm.
Okay, Cross.
Yeah. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
You said you potentially recognized the woman at your door via her tattoos.
All right. Yes, I think I said that because I saw some tattoos on their arm and walking away I said it could be the lady.
Okay. Approximately how many times have you seen her prior to...
Once.
Was that the incident where her dog came to your house?
No, later on.
When
she came with the dog to the house that day.
Okay. Was that the one where they brought you chocolates, or was that the other?
No, they. Dog? I didn't see the chocolates. No.
You described your dogs as. You were asked if the dogs were loud and boisterous, and you said they were really not quiet.
Excuse me.
Or the dogs. You were asked if they were loud and boisterous, and you said they were really not quiet.
They were. Make it.
I just want to clarify which dogs we're talking about.
The pit bulls.
Well, I don't know nothing about pit bulls.
Her dogs.
I don't know nothing about her dogs.
During the response time, you watched her walk. Was she walking on the sidewalk?
No, across the street.
Across the street?
That's correct.
And this was straight, May. from
that house, the railroad, yeah,
to right over here?
That is correct.
And did you see, were you able to see the other house letter in?
I don't remember. I don't think so.
Did you see her sit down on the curb?
Don't remember that case.
Do you remember where she was when the police showed up?
Nope.
And you've alternately described what she was wearing as a robe or a blanket. Is it a blanket sort of worn like a robe, like over her head and wrapped around?
That's probably like if she was cold or something, or scared.
And you said a pattern. What type of pattern was on this blanket?
I mean, square.
Okay.
That detail I didn't really look for.
Right hand, face that gentleman right there for me.
I solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give in this action be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, self God.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. May I see you? Please state your complete name, spelling both your first and last name correctly.
Arthur D. Harris, A-R-T-H-U-R, D, and Harris, H-A-R-R-I-S.
Thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Mr. Harris. Are you here locally from Las Vegas?
No.
Okay, what state do you live in?
I live in California.
What is it that you do for a living?
I'm a paramedic.
Okay. How long have you been a paramedic for?
I've been a paramedic for 3 years, and prior to that I was an EMT for 12.
Okay, and that's in the state of California?
Yes.
I'd like to turn your attention back to August of 2014. In the first week of August, did you come to Las Vegas?
Yes.
And what was the reason for you coming?
Every year we do a family vacation, usually Palm Springs or Las Vegas, Oakland, and we just happened to be in Las Vegas at the time.
Okay. And when you say we, how many family members are we talking about?
Probably about 15 actually staying at the house, and we have some that live in Vegas that come visit, so 15 and maybe 25
people. Okay. So when you come to Las Vegas, you just said the house, so you don't stay at a hotel?
We've stayed at timeshares before. Sometimes we do like VRBO, property rental houses, stuff like that.
And so in August of 2014, when you came to Las Vegas, did you guys do a VRBO, like a rental?
Yes, we did a house rental.
And for 15 people, I'd imagine you need a pretty good size house.
Yes.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you what's already in evidence as States 178. Is that already in evidence? Okay, thank you. There's just a sticker. And I'm going to zoom in for you. Do you see the home that you and your family members were staying in August of 2014? And if you want, I can also approach with this as well.
I believe it's this corner house.
And you know what, that screen in front of you, I should have told you, I apologize. You can actually circle and it will circle. Okay, thank you so much. So now, so you're staying there with several family members. and I want to talk to you about a specific day during your vacation. I'm going to turn your attention to the early morning hours of August 8th of 2014. In those early morning hours, did you hear something that kind of caught your attention?
Yes.
What was it that you heard?
We heard like banging on the door, someone knocking really hard at the door.
When you heard that, what did you think?
Well, we had a number of relatives staying, so I just thought somebody forgot the code to the keypad and they were trying to get in the door.
So did you get up and go to help them?
Not initially.
Are you laying in bed at that point in time?
Yes.
And as you're laying in bed, do you start hearing knocking from multiple areas of the home?
Yes.
Can you explain to me how that you kind of figured that out?
The home had multiple entrances. One had a keypad lock where you could actually punch in numbers and get the rest had to be open from the inside. So we have been using all the different doors throughout the day. So it just sounded like the knocks were in the, I believe it would be the northern end of the home initially, and it just kind of progressively got louder, and it ended up in the door where that was closest to my room, the room that I was staying in.
Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to show you a blown-up version of the house, which you don't have the party going to stipulate into evidence. This is State Proposed 172.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, 172 is admitted?
I believe yes, we're stipulating. Not objecting, just for the record.
That was my understanding. Go ahead.
Thank you. I'm going to zoom in for you, if you don't mind, so you can kind of explain to the ladies and gentlemen of the jury. I'm doing the brightness, sorry. I made fun of Mr. Stevens for doing that earlier. Here I go. Okay, so that's the house we're talking about, right?
Correct.
So can you give us an idea of where the different points of entry of the house are that you're getting from?
So up top here, I'm not sure if it's on the right or the left side of the driveway, but in this area there is a door that leads to maybe like a hallway. It was where the kids were. They had bunk beds and things there. There was a hallway with multiple other bedrooms along here. There was another door about here, and then there was a door this way here, and this was like a den area, and then the master bedroom would be this area where I was staying.
Okay, and you could kind of hear this, you said banging.
Yeah.
Is that what you said?
Yes.
In all those points of the home.
Yes.
And just for the record, Your Honor, he has located a door on the entrance of the top of the picture, and then another door towards the first part of the cement on the top of the picture, and then again in front of the first right square, and then in the middle of the home, and then a den, and then an entrance of the master bedroom, which is the last part of the house.
Well, this here isn't a door. The door would be this,
okay.
This, and this one. This was just the hallway where the rooms were.
So there were three doors?
Yes, there were three doors, to my knowledge, on the front side of the house,
right.
Not including like sliding glass doors on the back or...
Understood. Perfect.
Entrances to the back of the home.
Thank you for that clarification. Okay, so then can you tell me after you hear this continuing banging, at some point do you decide, I'm going to go figure out what's going on?
At some point, me, niece, sister-in-law, they were on the northern end. My niece and sister-in-law were on the northern end of the house. We kind of get up at the same time. They beat me to the door, and they're like, hey, it's some girl out here that's bloody, and I'm kind of like, I mean, it's 4 a.m, I'm kind of like, just like, huh, like, what's going on? And they're like, I don't know, so I go over to the door, I look out, and she was at, the door here has a glass window. Both doors have glass windows. The door that is like catacorner there does not. She was knocking at the door that does not have a glass window. So I'm looking out the glass window at her. She appeared, initially I thought she was drunk. She appeared to be stumbling. I mean, she was slurring. I'm like, hey, how can I help you?
She was stumbling, slurring her words.
Were you talking through the door?
I was talking through the door.
Okay.
Yeah, just loud, like, hey, you know, like, because she was knocking back towards me, and she started to walk towards the door that we're at. And then I believe she said she'd been beaten up. She needed help. She was just like begging for help, like, please help me, help me, help me. And I'm like, okay, what's going on? She's like, I'm beat up. And so I was like, okay, I'll call the police. So at that time, I didn't open the door because of there's bushes here, and there's a wall that where you can't really see around. So I kind of told my wife, like, could be a setup. We opened the door, somebody could run in, and we had kids there, all of our family members. So I tell her, like, hey, I'll call the police. So, I mean, it's obviously a rental home. I don't know the address by heart. I have to go back into the kitchen where the address is written down. So once I call 911, I'm reading the address off of, like, a sticky note or notepad where we had it written down because we had been giving it to family members all day. So after I call 911.
Actually, before you move on, I would like to, okay, I'm going to play the 911 call that you made, if that's okay with you, and see if you recognize it.
Okay.
And then ask you some questions afterwards.
What's the exhibit?
Yes, Your Honor, thank you. It states proposed 159, and the parties are stipulating to its admission.
Is that correct, counsel?
It is.
Okay, submitted. Thank you. Go ahead.
Friday, August 8, 2014, 0414 and 29 seconds.
911 emergency, Salim 14565.
Hi, we need to probably some here, possibly the paramedic.
Yeah.
The address is 2176 Pueblo Circle in Las Vegas, 89169.
What's going on?
There's a lady outside down on the hood. She has blood over her. She thinks she was beat up.
All right, have you called before on this?
No, sir.
What's your name?
My name is Arthur.
Arthur, your last name?
Harris.
And the phone number you're calling from?
You knew it. Whose number is it? What number is it? 919-964-3606.
And she's in front of that address right now, 2176
West? Yes.
Okay, I'll let the officers know that's where she is right now.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Do you remember making that phone call?
Yes.
So you said to the 911 to dispatch, you said there's a woman outside, she's all bloody. Can you explain to me what you could tell when you guys were on opposite sides of the door to one another?
Well, she was wrapped in a sheet. You could see there was blood coming from her face. There was blood on the sheet. And that was pretty much what I could see.
Okay. And so you make this 911 call. Now explain to us what happens after you hang up with 911.
So after I hang up with 911, I go back to the door and I tell her, like, okay, the paramedics, the police, they're on their way. And she just kept saying thank you. And after she says thank you a number of times, she just falls to the ground. So at that point, I'm thinking to myself, like, all right, if there are people, like, waiting there to run in the house, after I say now the police are coming, they're probably going to leave. And she didn't leave, so I'm kind of thinking, okay, it's something serious. I should go out and check her. So I just tell my sister-in-law, niece, wife, like, hey, as soon as I go out, just close the door, lock the door, don't open it for nothing until the police get here. So I go out, I go outside, she's on the ground, I'm like trying to talk to her, She was answering some questions, but she was still kind of slurred speech. I remember asking her, like, what happened.
Were you at that point trying to provide her with medical care? Are you assessing her injuries?
Yes.
And when you get out there and now you have an opportunity to look at her up close, you originally said that you thought she was drunk.
Right, yes.
When you get out there and, you know, you see her face to face, do you think she's drunk?
No.
What are you thinking at that point?
At the point where I make contact with her and I'm up close with her, I can see that she has blood from the mouth, swelling over her entire face. She's clearly been beat or hit with something. She's bleeding, so she was clearly in distress.
Okay. Do you know, touch her in any way, try to provide her any aid?
Yes, I never touched, like, the bloody parts because I didn't have gloves. I don't have any equipment. But I did, during an assessment, I was asking her questions like, do you have trouble breathing? I mean, I was what we call palpating or pressing on her stomach to see if she had any pain there. Most of the bleeding, it wasn't controlled, but it wasn't like gushing out to the point where I had to try to apply pressure to stop it.
When you would palpate the different injuries of, the different places of her body and ask if she was feeling pain, was she able to communicate to you whether or not she was in pain?
She was, but she was crying. She was like hysterical. And she was just saying like, help me. But she was able to say that she did have pain in all the places that I was asking her.
Okay. Was she able to tell you who it was that did this to her?
Yes.
I'm not asking for her answer. I'm just asking.
So yes or no?
Correct.
Okay.
Was she able to tell you who did this to her?
Yes.
Was she able to tell you whether or not a weapon was used?
Yes.
Was she able to tell you how it was that she was beaten? And let me clarify that. I mean, like, what body parts touched her body parts? Does that make sense?
Yes, I asked those questions, so yes, she was.
And she was able to answer all of those.
Is that yes?
Yes.
Was she having problems answering all of your questions? Like, was she clear-headed?
No.
Well, clear-headed calls for speculation. Trouble answering the questions is different than was she clear-headed.
Okay. All right, why don't you clarify the question?
Was she able to have a conversation like you and I are having?
No.
Were you able to assess whether or not she was in and out of consciousness at that point?
Yes.
And was she conscious the entire time?
She was conscious the entire time.
Okay. After you made that 911 call, do the police come shortly after that?
Yes, a few minutes. I mean, obviously when you're there, it seems like a long time, but I mean, probably a few minutes later.
Okay. When you were treating her and when you were having these conversations with her, were you right here behind these bushes, kind of like in this corner where the L makes?
Yes.
And all of your contact with her was outside the home?
Yes.
Is that behind a fence? Like, is there a fence in that area, or what is in that picture? Is that area like a patio? How would you explain it?
It was kind of weird. It is a patio, but it had like a, I'm not sure it was exactly fenced in, but it was a wall with like where they had the trash can. So it wasn't a patio. It wasn't anywhere like you could go. It's a patio and then like maybe a retaining wall that maybe like 5 feet high with the trash can.
Okay.
Like on the side of it.
And when you said that, you know, you let her know, hey, I called 911, and she said thank you several times, and then she fell. When you say fell, did she like fall over something, or is it more like of a collapse?
More like a collapse.
Okay. And it's at that point you felt like you needed to go outside and help her?
Correct.
Thank you so much. That concludes my direct examination, and I'll pass the witness.
Okay, Cross.
Long Vegas?
Yeah, not quite, but...
Did you fly out of here on your own, or did the DA's office fly you out here?
The DA's office flew me out here.
And just paying for your stay while you stay out here?
They are.
On the morning of August 8, 2014, you stated that you heard some banging, correct?
Correct.
And you stated that you thought it was a family member at first, correct?
Yes.
So is it fair to say when hearing this banging, this wasn't a frantic banging?
No, it's not fair to say that.
Is it something that startled you?
Startled? No.
Can you describe the pattern of bangs?
What do you mean, like the pattern on me? Describe how many times she knocked, or?
Well, like, was it as if somebody was frantic trying to get in, or was this possibly a family member who...
I mean, obviously, I thought it was a family member who was trying to wake us up, or thought that we were sleeping and banging hard enough to wake a whole house up for somebody to get up.
How long did you spend with Ms. McAday outside of the home?
I don't know, several minutes.
And you, what appears to be, treated her a little bit, is that correct?
That is incorrect. I would say I assessed her. I didn't treat.
Now, you said that you were pressing on the areas of the body that didn't.
Right, that's correct.
You had mentioned the stomach. Where else were you pressing on?
That was pretty much it. Just the stomach.
Now, in your 911 call, you had stated to dispatch, or do you recall stating to dispatch, there's a lady outside down on the curb?
Do I recall? No.
Would help refresh your recollection if I show you the transcript of the 911 call?
Good, sure.
Now, do you at all recall the statement from the audio recording?
The one we just listened to?
Yes. I'll go ahead and show you the transcript.
Okay.
Oh, Mr.
Sill? No, take it up to her to refresh her recollection.
Do I have an opportunity to review it? I'm not sure.
Thank you so much. You provide that to
us. You're on the air, President? Yeah, sure. So just review that and then tell them when you're done reviewing it.
Okay.
Now that you've had an opportunity to review it, does that refresh your recollection?
I don't remember saying curb, but I mean, it's 2 o'clock in the morning, so 4 o'clock in the morning. I could have.
So to be clear, do you or do you not recall stating?
I don't
There's
recall.
A lady outside down on the curb.
I don't recall the word curb saying she was on the curb, no.
Okay. And while viewing Ms. McAday, while simultaneously being on the phone with 911, do you believe that your statements were accurate?
I wasn't on the phone viewing her and on me. I was on the phone and seeing her at the same time.
Correct.
Because I had to go get the address. So while I'm calling 911, I'm in the kitchen of the home, reading the address off of a sticky note.
Do you believe that your recollection at the time of making this 911 call was better than your recollection today?
No.
You think it was just as accurate?
I'm sure.
And you don't remember saying that?
I don't remember saying curve.
Do you recall confirming with the police that she was out front?
I'm not sure. With the actual officers or dispatch? Or?
With dispatch.
Yeah.
Now, can you describe around the rental house that you were staying at? In the picture, it appeared to be a lot of greenery all around the house. What exactly was that that we saw in the picture?
I believe it's just an aerial view of the house of trees. I don't think there's like any bushes I'm not sure what, they're just trees.
So you don't recall seeing any bushes out front there? Where Ms. McIntyre was?
Not like, there is a bush in the walkway. So they're not, it's not like all around the house. Like this entire part is not a bush. That's a big tree. It was a bush in the walkway.
By the walkway, you described the retaining wall. Do you recall which wall I'm talking about?
Correct.
Approximately, how tall is that retaining wall?
I would guess like maybe 5 feet.
At the time that you first saw Ms. McIntyre, she was right outside of your door?
Yeah, she had her back turned towards me. She was at the door that did not have the glass.
And from the time that she was at the front of your door, you had stated that you had gone outside. At any point in time, did she go back out to the street?
No.
Nothing very wrong.
Redirect?
I'm going to play the beginning part of your 911 call and let me know if you hear the part about the curb, if that's okay, all right?
Okay.
Ready? Yes. Sorry, I thought it was earlier.
Friday, August 8, 2014, 0414 and 29 seconds.
911 emergency, Salim 14565.
Hi, we need the police on here, possibly the paramedic.
What's the address?
Somebody, I don't know, address is 2176 Pueblo Circle in Las Vegas, 89169.
What's going on?
There's a lady outside down on the door. She has blood over it. She seems to be good.
Alright, have you called before on this?
Are you saying curb?
I said there's a lady outside.
Okay. I'm going to just rewind it a little bit. You said a lady outside, and then what's the next thing you say?
Has blood over it. She seems to be good.
Sorry, didn't remember.
Alright, have you called before?
In Las Vegas, 89169.
What's going on?
There's a lady outside down on the door. She has blood over it. She seems to be good.
Alright, have you called before?
There's a lady
outside, bamming on the door. She said she has blood on her. She said she was beat up.
There's nothing about a lady being on the curb.
No.
Ms. McAday wasn't on the curb.
No, she was on the porch.
You don't know Ms. McAday, correct?
No.
Have you ever even seen her?
No.
Nothing further.
Any recross?
Nothing further.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Good for me. Boxing, standing. Raise your right hand and face that gentleman right there for me.
Solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give this action, be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but truth, so help you God.
I do, yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Please state your complete name, spelling both your first and last name for the records.
Yes, my name is Jason Lafreniere, Jason Lafreniere.
One second, Robert, please. Can you proceed, Governor?
Yes.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Detective. How are you employed?
I am a detective with the Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department.
And how long have you been with Metro?
I've been with the department for over 15 years.
What section do you work in currently?
I currently work in the sex crimes unit.
All right. And in August of 2014, what section were you working?
I was also with the sex crimes unit.
Thank you. Just briefly, can you discuss the difference between the job duty of a patrol officer and the job duties of a detective?
Yes, ma'am. A patrol officer are usually our initial responding officers. They conduct a preliminary investigation, fairly rudimentary.
gather evidence or gather statements, preliminary statements, and then if need be, if it needs to move on to a detective, they would contact us for further investigation.
Now, when they gather statements, do they do sit-down interviews that are recorded and then later transcribed?
Not typically.
Is that something more that a detective does?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I'd like to ask you some specific questions in regards to August 8th of 2014. That morning, were you called out to do an interview with the victim of a sexual assault?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, how is it that you became involved in this investigation?
Each day, there's a sexual assault detective who's assigned to take calls. We call him a bucket person or the on-call person. I believe that I was that day because I was approached by another section, either a detective or supervisor from another section, asking if I could assist with an interview.
Okay. Normally, if there is an aspect of sexual assault, let's say, for instance, this investigation had aspects of domestic violence, is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
But it also had an aspect of sexual assault. So would it be common for a detective within the sexual assault unit to do the interview?
Yes, ma'am.
And why is that the proper protocol?
Multiple reasons, but training. We've been through extensive training on interviewing. Limiting re-victimization, working with victims of sexual assault, comfort level. We're very comfortable talking about it, experience. We've been doing this for multiple years and just our experience and training.
Okay, so it wasn't uncommon for you to be called out to handle that part of the investigation?
No, ma'am, I've done that many times.
Okay, so generally, I'm going to ask you some questions about the interview with an individual by the name of Christine McInday in a moment. But I'd like to ask you some general questions in regards to just how you conduct your interviews and terminology, etc., if that's okay with you.
Yes, ma'am.
So when a common layperson hears the term sexual assault, I think generally people think of, you know, a penis and a vagina. Would you agree with me that that's generally what comes to mind?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, are those the only forms of sexual assault that you encounter or investigate?
No, ma'am.
Can you explain kind of the breadth of your investigations, what type of calls that you respond to?
Yes. I can respond to any call with some type of sexual element. That could be forced oral sex, could be digital penetration, anal penetration, groping, touching, rubbing. There's even times where we will get called out to, depending on the age of the victims, sometimes to statements or comments made. It depends, but there's a whole litany of reasons that we will respond out anything with a sexual element.
And when you use the term digital penetration, are you referring to the insertion of femurs into the vagina or into the anus?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. A term that we both use just right now is the term penetration. Again, when a layperson hears the term penetration, generally they think that that means in the vaginal hole. Can you explain, when you're doing your investigation, the difference in your definition of penetration when you speak to victims?
I'm going to object. This calls for a legal testimony that the court is to provide. She's asking what the legal
definition. Come on up, please. All right, go ahead and ask a different question.
Sure. So when you're asking questions about penetration, are you trying to determine whether or not, first of all, I want to back up for a second. So we should probably talk about, and I apologize for having to use these terms, but I'm sure you're quite familiar with them being a sexual assault detective. But when we are talking about the different parts of the vagina, so we have the labia majora, which is what's referred to as like the bigger lips, is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
And then inside you have the smaller lips, which are referred to as the labia minora.
Yes, ma'am.
And then you have the vaginal hole, which is inside of the labia minora. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So when you are doing an interview, are you only trying to figure out, in terms of penetration, whether or not something was inserted into the vaginal hole?
No, ma'am.
Okay, what are you trying to determine?
A sexual penetration defined by any intrusion, however slight, in that of the genital area or any opening of a person's body, and that's just by NRS, but it can be any intrusion through, and even including the labia majora, labia minora.
So anything past the labia majora?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So when you meet with Ms. McInday, are you there to investigate anything having to do with the domestic violence component?
Not specifically. That is kind of the segue into the interview, beginning with that, but that is not what I was there to investigate, no ma'am.
Okay. And so are you there purely to just discuss the sexual assault?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Where do you respond in order to do this interview?
In this particular case, to Sunrise Hospital.
When you respond to Sunrise Hospital, do you make contact with Ms. McInday?
Yes, ma'am.
And can you please describe how she looked upon your initial arrival?
Yes, ma'am. I recall her eyes were swollen, almost shut, if I'm mistaken. She had lacerations and bruising to her face. I believe there were cut marks on her ears and head. There was, I don't remember else where there were injuries, but there was significant, obvious facial injuries.
Okay. What was her demeanor when you were speaking with her?
She was visibly emotionally upset. There were moments during it where she was crying, pretty intense. Visibly emotionally upset and soft-spoken at times and a little difficult to understand.
That was my next question. Was due to the injuries to her mouth, at some points was it difficult to understand what she was saying?
Yes, sometimes it was, not due to her being not lucid. It was just more that she wasn't able to speak clearly or loudly at some points.
Okay. Before you begin the formal interview with her, do you lay down kind of some ground rules for the interview?
Yes, ma'am. I do that regularly. Yes, ma'am.
And that was going to be my question. Is that pretty much done whenever you conduct an interview?
Yeah. Almost every time. I won't say every time because there's definitely some dynamic situations where it does not happen, but and I would say 98 to 100% of the time in there that there are, I do lay those ground rules, yes, ma'am.
And can you explain what those rules are and why it is that you discuss with the individual you're interviewing them?
Yes, ma'am. Again, it's going to be dependent on the age and the mental capacity of the individual I'm interviewing, but in this specific situation, or more commonly, I like to make sure that they understand. If they don't understand, or if I get something wrong, or if I make a mistake, to please stop me and correct me immediately. I explain the importance of accuracy. I always go over, if they don't know something or they can't remember, it's perfectly okay to say that they don't know or they can't remember and not just guess or estimate unless I ask them to. I also like to establish that we're going to be truthful through the course of the interview. I'm expecting them to lie to me, but I just like to make sure that they understand if somebody lies to me about something small, I can only assume they lie to me about something big, and it could have an effect on the case, and I just ask for an agreement to be truthful through the course of the interview.
Do you also explain to them that you're going to have to ask some kind of personal, private questions?
Yes, ma'am. Anytime it's dealing with a sexual element, I like to explain that based on my experience, I know I'm going to be asking some intimate questions, personal questions, and if they don't understand why I'm asking those questions, they are welcome to ask me, and I would explain it to them.
Okay. So In speaking with Ms. McInday in your interview, did she have the ability to tell you who it was that did this to her?
Yes, ma'am, she did.
Was she able to tell you who was present during different parts of the incident?
Yes, ma'am.
Was she able to discuss what acts were done to her?
Yes, ma'am.
During your interview, at any point did she point out injuries to you where a knife was used?
Yes, ma'am.
And could you see either lacerations or sharp force injuries to those areas?
Yes, ma'am.
And where on her body were those?
I believe somewhere on, they were on her hand. Her ears stand out to me. I remember her saying that it was pressed against her head and ears and showing me those marks. She said that she had been cut on the legs, though I do not recall seeing her legs. She was covered up on the bed, as far as I remember, but mostly to the head, face, and her hands.
Okay. And then were there specific questions in regards to the aspects surrounding the sexual assault in and of itself?
Yes, ma'am.
And during that sexual assault, was she able to tell you whether or not there was contact made past her labia majora?
No, ma'am. She did not specifically say that, but based on what she was explained to me and what she did disclose, I absolutely believe that it was. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
I'm going to object and move to strike it lacks foundation and sort of an opinion.
Come on up, please. All right, go ahead, counsel.
Okay, so I wanted to go back. All right, so when you were speaking with Ms. Mack today, did she discuss, without getting into what exactly she said, did she say what had happened to her in regards to contact with the defendant and her vagina?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And after you got done speaking with her and went through your report, did you believe that a sexual assault had occurred?
Yes, ma'am.
If someone licks their hand and then rubs the vagina from, let's say, from the anus up, you know, up to the lips, is that a sexual assault?
I would say yes.
Okay.
I'm sorry, again, that calls for a legal opinion.
Not for the purposes of whether or not you would, if... If you are investigating a case where a suspect has licked his hand and then rubbed the vagina from the anus up, you know, through the lips in an attempt to lubricate the vagina, is that something that you charge as a sexual assault?
And just to clarify, if there was no clothing on, yes. If they were clothed, then I would say no.
That's a good one.
Yes.
After you conduct your interview with Ms. McAday, do you then put in a request to have that interview transcribed, like typed out?
Yes, ma'am.
And then do you notify the detective in domestic violence whose investigation this is of your conversation?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And is that your only role in this investigation?
That is, yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much. That concludes my direct examination, Your Honor. I'll pass the witness.
Good for us.
Thank you.
Let's see if we can do this. Watch the mic on the top of the line.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
You said you're 15 plus years as an officer?
Yes, sir.
And how many years in the sex crimes unit?
I started in the sex crimes unit in November of 2007, so 9 plus.
So almost 7 years by the time you did this examination, or by examination, I mean the interview?
Yes, sir. That'd be I. Yes, sir. That's not what I mean.
In that time, you've been able to assess the people that you've spoken to's mental state, coherence?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I would say so.
Were there times and periods where Ms. McAday was not 100% coherent?
I wouldn't say not coherent. Maybe sometimes where I was not able to understand her. I don't know if I would attribute that to being coherent or just soft-spoken due to the circumstances. But the answer would be yes, sir, to that. Yes.
Thank you. I noticed several times in the interview she asked you to repeat questions so that she didn't understand.
That sounds accurate, yes, sir.
And many, many times she didn't recall. You asked her a question, she didn't recall what had happened.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
Can I have patient history references, please? That's all. I'm sorry, what's the
Yes, come on up. Go ahead, counsel.
Okay. I think where we were is you answered that there were a number of times that she wasn't able to recall.
I know there were times, yes, sir. That's correct.
Thank you. Was she able to identify the person she said attacked her?
Yes, sir, by name.
And was it also by, did you say it was a stranger?
No, sir, she did not.
She referred to him as her boyfriend?
Yes, sir.
Did you ascertain who lived with Ms. McNay in her house?
I asked her that question, yes, sir, and she said that she lived alone.
At some point during your interview, did you meet Ms. McNay's mother, or was Ms. McNay's mother there?
I don't recall her being present. I don't know if we met in passing on the way out or not, but I don't recall meeting her.
Sorry, I'm just trying to get
it. Oh, that's
all right.
No problem. Yes, sir.
Did you come to understand how long the altercation with her boyfriend was?
I don't recall. I'm sorry.
Did she address the noise level in the house during this incident? I'm going to ask more specifically.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Did you come to understand of whether there was or was not a good deal of yelling during this incident, loud yelling?
I believe I would have to ask to look at my statement to be exact. I'm sorry.
May I approach?
18. There are no line numbers, but 18. Okay.
Okay.
Are you able to answer the question at that point?
Yes, sir.
And did the piece of paper refresh your recollection?
It did, yes, sir.
What is the answer to the question?
That she recalled being yelled at while she was in the shower and he was outside of the shower door.
She discussed losing consciousness?
Yes, she discussed that as a possibility.
Was she able to recall what she was saying to her boyfriend during this conversation, what her boyfriend was saying to her?
I think for the most part the answer is no. I think she said she couldn't remember. When I asked what he was saying, she said she could not remember, and then again.
It's fair to say there were some specifics in there that she did recall.
Yes, sir, that's fair to say, yes, sir.
Okay, but there was a line of questioning where she didn't recall maybe the bulk of it.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
You said the incident lasted about an hour?
Oh, I'm sorry, I don't remember.
Did I ask that to you before?
You asked me if I figured out the length.
Sorry, Your Honor. 22 minutes out in the middle. May I approach the document? Would it help to look at the transcript to refresh for recollection?
Yes, sir, it would.
May I approach for that?
Yes, sir.
Did the document, in fact, refresh your recollection?
It did, yes, sir.
Are you able to answer the question?
Yes, sir.
What's the answer?
That it lasted about an hour, based on her statement. Yes, sir.
The hitting during that hour, was it an open fist or closed fist?
I believe that she disclosed both.
Was there one that was most of the time?
I believe she said open hand most of the time.
And at the end of the interview, you referred Ms. McNabe back to the domestic violence unit?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
And I'm sorry, you said something on direct about that, and I didn't quite catch it. Is that something you regularly do?
It's going to depend on the circumstances, but do you want me, I'm sorry.
I do. Please continue. And so, well, let me ask a question. What were the circumstances here that caused you to refer it back?
They had already begun the investigation into it. If I'm not mistaken, they had already processed or had criminalistics into the scene, or they had done their work. My understanding is somebody had already spoken with Ms. McInday, and I wasn't going in there looking for the details of the domestic violence, and since they had already been into it, I just helped with the interview and then requested the nurse.
Do you know someone named do you know a detective with the last name of Tomiana?
Yes, sir. I pronounce it Tomina, but yes, sir, I've worked with him.
Tomina?
Yes, sir.
And do you know if that's who you referred it back to?
It is, yes, sir.
And did you make any recommendations on original charges regarding sex counts?
I don't know.
Let me ask you this way. Did you recommend that Mr. Copenhagen be charged with gross lewdness?
I don't know. I don't remember what I recommended or if I even recommended a charge. I worked with Detective Tomino in sex crimes for a couple years, I believe.
And you don't specifically recall having a discussion with him about what, if any, sex charges were appropriate?
I would imagine we had the conversation, but I don't recall exactly what we would have said.
Would it be unusual to not have a conversation about that, having both interviewed her?
Of course, yes, sir.
So, and this was about 2.5 years ago?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
Fair to say you don't specifically recall that it would be unusual not to have had that conversation?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
Thank you. I'll pass the witness.
Detective Buckman, I have a few questions about what Ms. McInday was able to remember.
Yes, ma'am.
So, at any point in time, if you'd like to see some of your, any part of your statement, let me know, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
And if I refer to it, I'll provide you with a page number. So your interview, it looks like, started, I think it said about 11 o'clock in the morning, and it concluded at 11:38. Does that sound about right to you?
That sounds about right, yes.
Okay, let me grab my pen. So defense asked you that there were several times where she was not able to remember things. So I want to ask you a few questions about that. Was Ms. McIntyre able to tell you what she was wearing?
Yes, she was.
Was she able to tell you what an individual by the name of Corey Thomas was wearing?
Yes, she was.
Was she able to tell you that the defendant and Mr. Thomas got into a 10-minute altercation?
I don't recall the exact amount of time, but I do remember her saying they were in an altercation.
Okay. Do you want to take my word for it, or would you like to look at it?
I'm going to take your word for it.
Okay. Are you going to take my word for it? I'll be good to the
patient. I've seen it.
Thank you. And she did say it lasted about 10 minutes per your recorded interview.
However, I'm going to object based on hearsay. Come on up.
Was she able to state to you whether or not threats were made to Mr. Thomas?
Yes, ma'am.
Was she able to state to you whether or not threats were made to her?
Yes, ma'am.
Did she thus discuss with you that whether or not she had a convention the following day?
Yes,
a tattoo convention, I apologize.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Was she able to discuss with you whether or not the defendant went through her Instagram and Twitter?
Yes, ma'am.
Was, I already asked one of those. In regards to the things that she could not remember, is it true that she couldn't remember what, if anything, the defendant had said to Corey?
It's without objection of deleting. Overall.
Yes, she recalled what was said to Corey.
Okay. Were there points that then, let me get this to you, one second, Detective Lafreniere, sorry.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'm showing you, or I'm going to refer to page 11, and your question was, did the defendant say anything to Corey? And she said that she couldn't remember what he said. Do you remember her saying that?
I will take your word for it.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
And then you asked, did Corey say anything to the defendant? And she said, I can't remember that either. So those were two things that she couldn't remember. Is that correct?
That sounds accurate, yes, ma'am.
Okay. Was she able to discuss the very first hits before she got in the shower? Could she remember that aspect of it?
Yes, ma'am. So.
Okay. And so, I'm going to show you in regards to page 17. She said, I don't believe I lost consciousness. I'm not sure, but I'm having trouble remembering the first part. I just remember the shower. So she couldn't remember the first hits or how she got in the shower. Is that fair?
Yes, ma'am.
So besides what the defendant said to Corey and what Corey said to the defendant and how she got in and out of the shower, was there anything else that she could not recall?
I believe that when I think I asked what the defendant said to her and what she said to the defendant was, I believe when the hitting was taking place, again, I would have to look at my statement, but I believe that was the other thing.
Okay. But in regards to your 38-page statement, or her 38-page statement, your 38-minute interview, besides what the defendant and Corey said to each other, and besides getting in and out of the shower and what the defendant was saying when he was hitting her, was there anything else that she could not remember?
I apologize. I would have to look at the whole statement to be 100% sure, but that's how I believe that that is accurate. Yes,
is it fair to say that she was able to give a great amount of detail?
Yes, ma'am.
Defense asked you some questions in regards to whether or not she was able to say anything that the defendant said to her. Do you remember those questions?
Yes, ma'am.
Isn't it during your interview, she told you that the defendant told her he was going to kill her?
That's correct, yes, ma'am.
And that he told her, that's my pussy and I'm going to take it back?
Yes, ma'am.
And that...
I'm going to object. We're now past the point of hearsay.
Come on up, please.
in multiple circumstances, Ms. McIntyre was able to communicate to you things that the defendant had said to her throughout the incident?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you so much. I'll pass the witness.
Okay. Recross?
There isn't. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Let's go ahead and take our afternoon break. We'll take about 10 minutes or so. During this recess, you're admonished not to talk or converse among yourselves or with anyone else on any subject connected with this trial, or to read, watch, or listen to any report of or commentary on the trial or any person connected with this trial by any medium of information, including without limitation, newspapers, television, the internet, or radio, or to form or express any opinion on any subject connected with this trial until the case is finally submitted to 10 minutes.
All rise.